Hello, everybody. I'm Julie Bakk. The 2015 legislative session is now underway with the House and Senate having met simultaneously. We will air that Senate floor session for you in just a few moments. But first, this past election saw a change in leadership in the Minnesota House. It is now led by the GOP majority. This could make things a bit more challenging for the DFL-led Senate to get some of its priorities funded. To assess the dynamics of this 2015 legislature, we caught up with Dr. Larry Jacobs of the Humphrey Institute. So, Dr. Jacobs, a significant change leading into the 2015 session is the change in the majority party in the House. So first, what do you think the key issue or issues were that spurred voters to change the makeup of the legislature and yet retain Governor Dayton?
Well, the reality is we have different electorates. Statewide, the Democrats have an advantage because they build up pretty large majorities in the Twin Cities, 150 to 200,000 voters, and it's very difficult for Republicans to make that up statewide. But when you look at the distribution of votes around the entire state, what you see is the Republicans have a much better spread, particularly in midterm elections. So if you were to look at a map, what you would see is bright blue in Ramsey County and Hennepin County. That's where Dayton and Frank had built up large majorities. And then you look around the entire state and you see red in a large part of the state of Minnesota. For instance, Jeff Johnson won 53 of the 87 counties in the governor's race. So the bottom line is Republicans tend to do a bit better, particularly in midterm elections, in terms of the House districts, whereas the Democrats have an advantage statewide.
Moving on, the House GOP came out early stating its priorities, which include jobs in the economy, transportation, and loosening state regulations. The governor said these are goals of his as well. However they get there, however, differs. So do you think that the House, the Senate, and the governor will be far apart in policy?
Well, it's certainly going to have some battles here. It's just not avoidable. And the big battle is, of course, going to be on the amount of spending and where the revenue comes from. So in transportation, you've got a number of complicating factors. The first one is going to be, where is that money going to come from? And some Republicans believe that no new revenue is needed, whereas there may be a few Republicans, particularly in the House, who are willing to accept some kind of gas tax in the metro area, perhaps. But I think there's also going to be the ongoing division between metro area legislators who are concerned about transit, and then the greater Minnesota legislators, Republican Party, but also some Democrats who are focused more on roads and bridges. So I think it's going to be a matter of finding that kind of mix of multimodal transportation.
And playing off of that, the House GOP has already stated that a gas tax increase is off the table. So many are calling this a transportation session. So given that, do you think that there can be a $1 billion transportation bill in the Senate? Is that a feasible amount?
I think it's going to be really hard to get to $1 billion. You're just going to, unless you start mixing in bonding, and that hasn't really been talked about a lot off the campaign trail, but there may be a way in which you could look at new revenues and bonding. The key thing to remember in the House is the Democrats just need to pick up 6 seats. And are there 6 Republicans who might be willing to consider jumping parties? Probably not. I think that's expecting too much. But you can see in the leadership battle on Speaker that there are some very significant divisions within the Republican caucus and the House side. There may be ways in which the DFL and the governor could take advantage of that.
And Dr. Jacobs, do you anticipate any sleeper issues? What do you think they would be?
Well, I think one big sleeper issue, it's kind of a nightmare, is Minshew. What I think might be interesting this term is we might actually see some bipartisan efforts to try to fix the bill and fix how it's working. There are some areas, including the way it's been funded, the way in which the board has been selected and its composition, even in terms of some reorganization, how it operates, where there may be Republicans and Democrats who are willing to come together in that. Clearly, there's a need for a rethink. And my hunch is that there's going to be some bipartisan interest in that. There's also a process out of the federal government known as 1332 that allows a waiver. And we might find a really interesting bipartisan coalition and rethinking Minshew in some basic ways.
I want to ask you, with a divided legislature and this being a budget session, do you think that the parties can work together to get a budget passed on time, or do you think a special session is inevitable?
Well, you hate to start a session thinking that a special session or gulp, government shutdown, are things we're heading to. So my hope would be that they would be able to get their work done. But the reality is there are fundamental divides here, and they're really over principle. In addition, the governor has made it clear that he is going to stand his ground. He's willing to make some compromises, but he's going to stand his ground, and that really spells, I think, some real conflict here. So I'm expecting disagreement, conflict. Question is going to be, can it be managed, or are we heading for another kind of startling conclusion this session?
And we're standing here in the middle of a construction zone at the Capitol. The remainder tenants of this building are scheduled to be out in June once session ends. Do you think that's going to play into the final moments of session at all? Will that have any impact?
I don't think so. I think the whole issue of the Senate office building, it played on the campaign trail a little bit. Probably didn't play as well as Republicans thought it would. It was in a kind of a basket of issues they talked about. I think people see that as kind of water under the bridge, and I think it'll be more like, let's move into the new digs.
Okay, finally, the governor has expressed an interest in tackling issues of closing the academic achievement gap by expanding the approach considerably from solely a school-centered issue to societal issues like increasing funding and availability to low-income housing, access to healthy food, heating assistance. Do you think these are issues that the legislature will embrace, particularly a divided government?
I think that's going to be one of the casualties of divided government. I think Republicans really want to focus on the performance of the schools and looking at really profound reform of the education system. Minnesota was a leader in terms of school choice, in terms of vouchers and other areas 2-3 decades ago. And I think you're going to see Republicans pushing that and some Democrats coming on board and saying, yeah, it's time for reform of how the schools are really working, rather than this broader agenda of looking at the broader societal circumstances tied to education performance.
Okay, Dr. Jacobs, thank you for your time.
Good to be with you, always.
That was Dr. Larry Jacobs and his expectations for the 2015 legislative session. It's a session with a projected budget surplus of $1 billion. Shortly after the budget announcement was made in December, we sat down with Senate leadership to get their ideas on how that money could be appropriated and other expectations for the session as well. First up, Senate Majority Leader Tom Bakk. Could you lay out your priorities for the 2015 legislative session? And did those priorities change at all with the budget snapshot that was just released?
Well, I think the good news is this is the first time since 2001, the 2001 session, where we actually have a November budget forecast where the state has a structurally balanced budget going forward. In other words, our revenues and our anticipated expenditures are in balance. So it's been a long, long time since we've been in that situation. The state's been on a long roller coaster ride of managing deficits. So the really good news is the work of the last 2 years with the Democratic House and Senate and Governor Dayton have put the state's foundation on solid ground. And now, rather than like we were 2 years ago figuring out how we were going to manage a deficit, pay our schools back, now we're in a situation of having not all the accounting gimmicks are paid back, the schools are paid back. Just taking a look down the road into this next session with the $1 billion of money that we have, what are the strongest priorities for our state to continue our state to grow? And that's a very nice situation that we find ourselves in. So I'm meeting with caucus members now. I've got Senator Dibble coming in today to talk about transportation. Next week I've got the Chief Justice, Gilda, coming in to talk about the court's budget. So clearly there is inflation in the budget that's not counted in this surplus. We've got about a $40 billion budget over the next biennium, and we've got $1 billion now available. That's pretty small in relation to a $40 billion budget. So there's not a lot of money to sprinkle around in the state budget, so we're going to be very, very careful about investing in the things that we know are going to help Minnesota prosper. So certainly the constituents want a strong functioning court system, and so one of my first meetings is going to be with the Supreme Court Chief Judge to look at what do the courts need for a budget going forward in the next 2 years, and then we'll start going down the other kind of public safety priorities, take a look at the state's corrections budget. What do we need to keep our prison system intact? For public safety, of course, is one of the high priorities for, I think, all Minnesotans. So important that we probably don't talk about it a lot.
You said 2 years ago when you were elected majority leader that really at this point it was about managing expectations, especially those of your committee chairs. So as you wrestle with this $1 billion budget surplus, how do you manage those expectations?
Well, 2 years ago, it was pretty clear we were going to raise new revenue to balance the budget, to pay back all the accounting gimmicks and pay back the school shift, and we did that. So because we had all Democratic control, many of the constituents came to us and said, well, you know, as long as you're raising revenue, raise this revenue for my priority. And the list got pretty long. Now in the situation that we're in, I don't anticipate we're going to be raising general fund revenue. We're going to try to work within the general fund revenue that we have because we are structurally balanced. So from that standpoint, expectations are going to be managed by the fact that we're not going to be looking for new revenue. There just will be this competition among different groups. You know, one legislature can't bind the next one. It's a constitutional provision, so priorities might get adjusted. The House Republicans might, who are now control the House, might have different priorities than the Democrats might have had as we go forward. But I mean, having $1 billion available is certainly a much better situation than we've been in back to 2001.
So, Mr. Majority Leader, the jobs, growing jobs and the economy, it's fair to say that's a priority for everybody here at the legislature, but how to go about that differs considerably. Do you think that you can be in line with the views of the House and also of the Senate Republicans? Is there room for streamlining what that means, or do you think the policies are going to be just really vast?
Well, I think a strong economy, a strong growing economy are all four of the caucuses and the governor's priority, that we continue that. I think the challenge is the economy in the metropolitan area here is doing very well. Unemployment rate is very, very low. But you know, that prosperity is not being felt all the way across the state. So I do think now that we have some resources available, we're going to have to take a look at some different economic development incentives. I know we've got communities in rural Minnesota where we've got workforce housing issues. Certainly our transportation infrastructure is critical to rural Minnesota to move you know, our natural resource products around that are produced in rural Minnesota. So having some money to be able to look at how we can do something to make sure that all of our state prospers, not just the metropolitan area, which is a very, very strong economy. But I wish we had, you know, 2.5-3% unemployment statewide, but there are a lot of pockets in rural Minnesota where it's significantly higher. So I think you're gonna see the House and the Senate agree on trying to do something to make sure that all of the state prospers. It just seems like that's just not gonna happen on its own. It's gonna need some incentive from the state.
It's fair to say in the last 8-10 years, the divided legislature has really resulted in, you know, we've had unallotments, we've had government shutdowns. Are you optimistic that this legislature and governor can work together to end this thing on time, or do you think a special session is inevitable?
No, I think if people come to the table with the right attitude, clearly we're going to be able to carve off a deal. No one party is going to get everything that they want out of this session. My position has always kind of been, you know, well, let's just hope that we all can get what we really need. And as we figure out how to work within the resources that we have, I think we'll be able to accomplish that. I have a good relationship with the incoming speaker, Representative Dowd, and certainly I built a strong relationship with the governor over the last 4 years. So I'm looking forward to the session.
Any sleeper issues that you foresee? End-of-life legislation, anything that you think?
Well, I don't think the Senate's agenda is going to be much different than where we've been in the past. You know, we passed in 2013 some legislation to modify the state's sex offender program. There's a lawsuit in federal court, and we're kind of on the edge of that being declared unconstitutional. Unfortunately, the House weren't able to take the election year partisan politics out of that debate and they weren't able to get it done. So I think you'll see the Senate probably lead on that again. We take constitutionality really seriously, and if one of our programs is unconstitutional, I think we have an obligation to fix it. Absent that, the federal courts and the federal government are going to take over the program, maybe release everybody, maybe modify it and just send the state a bill. And I think we in the state of Minnesota can do a better job refining that program than just defaulting to the federal government. So, and certainly in 2013, the Senate passed a pretty comprehensive transportation bill. Again, election year politics got in the way over in the House. Our transportation infrastructure continues to deteriorate. Congestion continues to become a larger and larger problem here in the metropolitan area. So that certainly will be a priority for the Senate. And we're still kind of developing, now that we know how much money we have to spend, are there other places? We'll probably take a look at spending some money in the tax bill, some different kind of tax credits for priorities that members have. Certainly we'll probably have some tax credits for economic development. The governor's talked about additional tax credits for child care for working families. The federal government's probably going to pass some tax conformity issues that we're going to have to deal with, so that when people go to get their income taxes done with their accountant this winter, the state law and the federal law will conform, so you won't be taking a federal deduction and then adding it back into your state income when you do your state deduction. So that'll be spending. That'll probably be the first spending of this biennium, is spending on tax conformity so that people get the same kind of state tax credits that they get on their federal return.
Okay. Mr. Majority Leader, as always, thank you for sitting down with us. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
That was Senate Majority Leader Tom Bakk discussing some of the key issues of the 2015 legislative session, including his optimism that an early tax bill can be passed that allows for some tax relief. That idea also sparks the interest of Senate Minority Leader David Hann. We sat down with him for his perspective as well. Senator Hann, I'd like to begin with your priorities, your caucus priorities heading into 2015, particularly in light of the budget snapshot.
Well, we did hear today the forecast, at least the November forecast, that could change by the time we get to February. But I think the expectation is we're going to see a surplus. They said $1 billion, a little bit more than $1 billion this morning. We'll see. But for us, I think that it tells us that we have over-collected money. We have over-collected on the economy. We have raised taxes when we didn't need to. We've also spent a lot of money. And I'm not sure that that philosophy has really paid off in terms of economic growth. So from our perspective, we're going to be thinking about how can we do things that will make the economy stronger. And we do think that centers around cutting taxes, frankly. I think it's been 15 years ago was the last time there was a tax cut in Minnesota. We've seen a lot of tax increases over the years. There's been an argument made by Democrats and Governor Dayton that that's how you get economic growth, is by in growing the state budget. We think that it makes more sense to try to grow the economy and grow the budgets of families in the state of Minnesota.
There seems to be a consensus that there was underspending in the transportation area. Would you support tax increases if it came to that, to provide a roughly $1 billion transportation bill?
Well, again, we had a $2.5 billion tax increase just last year. We've now got whatever the surplus turns out to be, and we're looking at raising taxes again. I'm not sure that that's going to fly. We do think that there needs to be a higher priority on transportation, particularly roads and bridges. But I'm not in favor of having a gas tax as a part of that equation. I think we need to find ways to prioritize our spending, make sure what we're doing is effective, that we're not wasting the public money, and making sure that we're addressing the priorities the public has. So I think transportation is a priority, but it's not just for the metro areas, for around the state. And the focus we seem to have is a lot on light rail and those kinds of things that really don't solve the problems that we have across the state.
Senator Hann, would you support decreasing taxes or holding spending flat? What would you support, and would you also support keeping a lot in the reserves, having more, padding the rainy day fund, so to speak?
Well, I've been a little skeptical about padding the rainy day fund. I look at that as deferred spending. We're going to save up money, and what are we going to save it up for? Well, we're going to spend it at some time in the future. I think part of the challenge that we should put in front of ourselves is what can we do about spending. If you look at the size, the spending has grown in the last, say, 5 or 6 years, even the last decade. I mean, it's grown about a third in the last 10 years. That's a significant increase. We're talking about now a $40 plus billion budget. It's concerning to me that over this time we've grown and grown the mandate to have government do more and more things and more costly things. But I'm not sure that the public, the families in the state of Minnesota are really looking at their budget and saying, well, our budget is better, our wages are going up. I don't see that. I think we'd be better off to find ways to do things effectively. I think it's certainly possible you could cut taxes and hold the line on spending by doing a better job of prioritizing.
Would you support any increases in spending? Say, for example, K-12 education, it's likely they're going to seek increasing funds to help pay for facilities that are in disrepair, also to help pay for special education. Is there room, in your opinion, for more money for K-12?
Well, K-12 education, as long as I've been here 10 years or so, and when I served on a school board before that, it's always been about a 40%, 42% of the state budget. It's the single biggest thing that we spend money on. I'm not worried about not spending enough money on education. We're going to spend a lot of money on education. The thing that I think, though, is remarkable is that even though in the last 10 years that I've been here, we've talked a lot about trying to solve the achievement gap, this persistence in the lack of performance by some of the minority students as opposed to non-minority kids, we haven't made any progress on that, even though we have invested significantly more money. I think it's time to look at what the results are and not just look at how much money we spend. We've been focused on spending money as if that's proof that we've done a good job. We need to look harder at the results and think about what can we do differently than what we've done in the past and not just focus on how much money we're spending.
Going back to jobs and the economy, again, fair to say that that's a priority for each caucus and the governor. And the governor has even stated that the goals are generally the same, but how to get there likely differs. Is this going to be a sticky point?
Well, I think so. I mean, to me, the philosophy of the governor and the Democrats generally is they believe that if you raise taxes on everybody, more and more taxes, and do more and more state spending, that somehow that translates into economic growth and opportunity. We don't see that. I don't see that. I don't believe that works. I think, and most of us in our caucus, we believe that people are better decision makers about what the priorities are in their life. They are better at managing their own money. We ought to quit trying to figure out how we can take more money out of the economy, out of the pockets of the citizens of Minnesota, and let them make decisions and structure our policies so that they have the freedom to make decisions. Things like health care or education. These are things that we don't need bigger and more expensive policies. We need better systems to allow people to make decisions about the things in their life.
Let's talk a little bit about tax conformity. There seemed to be a general consensus that that was something that could be done early in session. So in your opinion, does this maybe signal that there is room for compromise and there is some agreement in some key areas?
Well, and you look at what is the argument for tax conformity? It's because it helps the economy in Minnesota if we are consistent with those tax reductions that are in the federal tax code. So how the Democrats can say they agree with it there, but when you come over here to look at this tax, no, that doesn't have that same effect. I think that it's pretty clear if you look at it, most people, if you get pin them down, will say that when you raise taxes, you're diminishing some economic activity in some way. I think our challenge is how do we get this economy to really go? The projections we saw this morning, they talk about depressed or slower growth in wages. They talked about the overall economic outlook is down from where they thought it was 6 months ago. These are not signs of a strong, robust economy. We keep hearing anecdotally about people leaving the state. We think we have to do a better job of clearing the way, letting people invest, take risks, grow businesses, find jobs. We need to do those things instead of piling on more and more programs and regulations.
So, understanding that you're in the minority, would you support something, for example, as you're looking at trying to find ways to grow the economy, some of the specifics, or one example that was brought up earlier today was expanding the daycare credit so more working parents can pay for daycare. Is that something you'd support, or would you rather see just a reduction in income tax or corporate taxes?
Well, I'd have to look at the particulars of any policy of that nature.
I guess the bigger question, let me rephrase it. Do you prefer tax changes that impact a specific individual in that way, in a categorically, for example, like daycare, or would you prefer something much more broad?
I personally think that you get a better effect on the economy if you do things that are broader and rather than rebates and those kinds of things, something that is structurally fixed, because I think for many people, they want to be predictable. They want to know what's coming, what's ahead. If they're uncertain, if they don't know from year to year whether this credit is going to be available or whether that rebate is going to still be in effect, or that causes uncertainty, that causes a resistance or reluctance to do the kind of investment and risk-taking that you really need to have to grow the economy. So I'm much more in favor of, let's do things, do them once, get done with it, put it on the table, and let the economy get out of the way, let the economy grow.
Any sleeper issues that if the Republicans were in control, they would bring out of the starting gate early on?
Well, that's a good question. There's a lot of things. Certainly, we've talked about transportation and education, which are the big things. I think in healthcare, there will be some efforts to try to change the governance structure of the Minsure body. I don't know if we can make any real changes to the whole Affordable Care Act, although I think we should, or at least we should try. So I'm not sure what we're going to see on those fronts. There's probably going to be lots of other local issues of one kind or another, but I don't know that we're going to see any real surprises this year. Certainly the, and I think Senator Bakk mentioned in, in his press conference that sex offender program has come under fire. There's been questions raised for a number of years. I think that's one thing that could be addressed.
Do you anticipate ending on time, or do you think a special session is inevitable?
Well, we don't need a special session, and I think we can end on time. It may come down to, and judging from what was said this morning, it sounds like Senator Bakk and Governor Dayton agree that they want to raise a gas tax. I'm not so sure, certainly on our side in the Senate, we're not going to go along with that. I'm not so sure that the House majority will. If that becomes a real impasse in terms of the budget negotiations, who knows? We shouldn't end up with a shutdown. I don't expect it. I think that you got a surplus. The budget's in good shape. I think we should end on time.
Okay. Senator David Hann, as always, we appreciate you sitting down with us. Thank you.
Glad to do it.
Now that we've provided you some analysis of the 2015 legislature, we'd like to air that Senate floor session from opening day.